tropical medicine. Very successful over the years, including the Indo-US Vaccine Action Plan, or our VAP program, that has been extraordinarily successful, as well as the decades-long US-Japan Cooperative Medical Sciences Program. If you move on to the research priorities and accomplishments, there are many of these. I want to emphasize the issue of genomics. Now, genomics is not the answer to everything. But in fact, there are such extraordinary opportunities now with the high sequencing and high throughput sequencing that we have available to us that has actually exploded over the last 5 years or so. And this has given us insight into everything from biosynthetic and metabolic pathways, immune evasion mechanisms, actually indicating and identifying the genomic basis of these structural proteins that are targets for therapeutics, for diagnostics, and for vaccines, as well as important insight into the mechanisms genomically of drug resistance. If you look at the genomes for neglected diseases, the accomplishments have really been extraordinary. We have completed genomes for all of the microbes on the left-hand side of the slide, and either in progress or planned genomic sequences for all those on the right. And this slide actually changes on a weekly and monthly basis because of the extraordinary capabilities that we have that we did not have as recently as 5 or more years ago. And this is something that I believe is going to transform how we approach neglected diseases. Some examples of resources that we have available, namely things that are made available to our grantees and our contractors, and I think that the problem with this is that many people are not really fully aware of the fact that we do have these resources available. For example, in schistosomiasis, the availability of parasites for people who want to study them listed on this slide. Snail intermediate hosts are available with filariasis, again, parasites, vectors, as well as a variety of microarray assays and other approaches. Leprosy, we have standardized quality controlled leprae research reagents, whole cells, cell fractions, nucleic acids, et cetera. I want to bring this to the attention. I think most of the people, but not all in the room, realize that when people come to us for help on projects, as we sat down in my conference room many times with some of you, that we do have resources available for the study that people are not fully aware of. Now, within this whole aspect of research, and since this is going to be addressed here at the meeting, I thought I would just touch on some of the things that you will be discussing. And those are lessons from three areas when you talk about the role of basic and clinical research: multiple and extensively drug-resistant tuberculosis, Chagas diseases, and the whole concept of vaccines in general. So let's start off very quickly with MDR. As we all know, it's a challenging disease whose research is showing extraordinary impact, as I'll get to in a moment. So some key facts that, again, you all are aware of, but I think for those who might be listening who are not, globally, multiple drug-resistant tuberculosis is an emerging and increasingly important problem, with about 4% of all new cases and about 20% of previously treated cases of tuberculosis are now being identified as MDR-TB. Over 300,000 cases among pulmonary TB patients in 2011 alone, and over 50% of them are in the countries of India, China, and Russia, a very important situation given the populations of those countries, including the extraordinarily large population in India and China. Extensively drug-resistant TB has been identified in over 80 countries. And we know now a very frightening concept that it is accounting for about 10% of what we've identified as multiple drug-resistant tuberculosis. And that number is not going down. It's actually going up. We have some sensitive point-of-care diagnostics that is one example of a real success story, and that is the GeneXpert for multiple drug-resistant tuberculosis, where you can not only make a diagnosis in less than 2 hours of TB, but because of the ability to detect rifampin-resistant, you could use that as a surrogate for multiple drug-resistant tuberculosis. When this first came out, I was a little bit skeptical about whether this would be adequately and appropriately and extensively used in the field. And I'm finding out that that, in fact, is not the case, that it is being extensively used. I had the opportunity to visit KwaZulu-Natal in South Africa just a few weeks ago, and I was thoroughly impressed by the extensive use of this and the efficacy that people are seeing with it and the value they're seeing with it in their clinics, in which tuberculosis is an overwhelming problem in South Africa, as most of you know. The issue with TB drugs is really an important situation. There's bad news and there's emerging good news. This is the bad news slide that almost all of us are aware of, that when you look at the development of new drugs specifically developed for tuberculosis, there has not been one approved by the FDA and other regular authorities in almost 50 years. There have been some repurposed drugs, as we know, that were developed for other diseases that are now being successfully used for tuberculosis, but not a tuberculosis-directed drug until most recently, as we're now starting to try and transform tuberculosis therapeutics. The challenges you're all aware of, the duration of therapy is unacceptable. We need to shorten it and simplify it because it compounds the problem of inducing multiple and extensively drug-resistant tuberculosis. We're in a very difficult situation with tuberculosis because, by definition, it's a combination therapy disease. And whenever you deal with combination therapy diseases and you add an additional drug that you need, you have the complex problem of how do you test such a drug in the arena of having to have more than one drug. It's a regulatory issue that we're dealing with, and I believe we're having some success and flexibility on the part of the FDA. We need to improve the drug regimens. There's no secret that TB and HIV have developed what I call a nefarious marriage in certain parts of the world, particularly in Southern Africa, where at least one-third of the individuals who are HIV infected have tuberculosis, and it's the leading cause of death among people with HIV. So you have to continually try and balance a complicated therapeutic regimen for HIV, which is at least three drugs, and a complicated regimen for tuberculosis. In Washington, taking care of patients myself who have HIV and TB, it's a very difficult situation when you get someone on the ward who has a resistant HIV together with a resistant tuberculosis. You actually need a computer to be able to figure out what it is that you're going to treat them with. We need to expand trial capacity, and we need to expand the drug pipeline. This is an example of that drug pipeline. They all look the same on the left-hand side. Concept, development, discovery, going to preclinical development and clinical development. I want to point out one of the success stories which gives me optimism is that if you look under the phase two column, one of those drugs, beta-quinoline, has just literally a few days ago gotten a recommendation from the FDA Advisory Committee for accelerated approval, which is a specific drug developed for tuberculosis. So we really are on that pathway that we really have not had much success with in the past. With regard to vaccine development, we have more than 15 novel TB candidates that are now in clinical trial. Five of them are in preclinical development, and a large number of next generation candidates using new platforms for vaccinology, where we're trying to bring TB into the 21st century when you talk about the kinds of platforms that we'll use in the pursuit of a vaccine for tuberculosis. So quickly, moving on to Chagas disease. Again, you all know, I need not tell you, it's a neglected disease with significant burden for which clearly more research and better interventions are needed. And I just want to spend a minute on just giving you a thumbnail sketch of that. Again, for those certainly not in this room who are not aware of it, there's some key facts that you need to put forth with regard to Chagas disease. There's about 10 million people infected with Trypanosoma cruzi worldwide, most of them in Latin America. But even now, a recent threat even here in the United States, as I'm sure you'll hear about from Peter Hotez, infected people can develop serious chronic cardiac and digestive problems. If the treatment is initiated soon after infectable, it is a curable disease, and there has to be control over the vector, the reduvid or kissing bug, and this is an important prevention method. So what about research priorities? Clearly, we need biomarkers and diagnostics, especially for the indeterminate phase prognosis and cure, because when you have a disease, and this isn't only for Chagas disease, it's for several of these neglected diseases. If you can cure it when you treat it early, before it goes into the chronic disease, you can't treat it early unless you know what you're dealing with. And that gets back to the recurrent theme of the importance of diagnostics in approach to this particular class of diseases. Therapeutics are important, including pediatrics and shorter courses, because children get bitten with the bug and get disease, as we know, as well as the development of vaccines. So with regard to some of the disease treatments, there are some selected examples of a growing pipeline of new drugs, two of which are listed on this slide, and I need not go into the details of them, but hopefully this is the beginning of a pipeline that will get even more robust. With regard to vaccine efforts, we really are at the basic research stage and not at the implementation stage, but you have to start somewhere, and I'm very pleased that we are actually starting in that direction. There's approaches such as whole parasite transmission blocking live vaccines, generating and testing genetically attenuated strains that happen to have enhanced immunogenicity, which is interesting. So you get two bangs for the buck because you get not only an attenuated benefit that you get from any vaccine, but you also see an enhanced immunogenicity. Epitope-based T-cell vaccines as well as glycolipopeptide vaccines, all of which are now being explored. And then finally, in this cluster, vaccines in general, highly cost-effective interventions where research has played a key role. So what about the impact of vaccines? Let's just think about it for a moment. They go well beyond the classic neglected diseases. I mean, if there is one intervention that has decades of cost-effectiveness proof, it certainly is vaccines. So if you just look at the number of lives, over 20 million, saved just over the past 20 years, when you look at measles mortality decreasing by almost 80%, almost 100%, and we'll get to 100%, incidence of polio has decreased, and the idea of eradication of polio, we are making progress despite a bump in the road a few years ago. I think we'll get there. Neonatal tetanus, over 90% decrease since 1988, and a 35% reduction in child deaths due to pneumonia with the introduction of the conjugate vaccine for children. Now, if you look at the economic benefits during the decade of the vaccines, I know many of you are aware of the Decade of the Vaccines Initiative. I've had the privilege and the honor of being part of that together with colleagues from the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, UNICEF, WHO, and several others, in including treatment savings, gains in labor productivity, and a variety of other approaches towards having the impact of vaccines over the next 10 years, well, it's actually eight now, we started a couple of years ago, by having the goal of immunizing 90% of the children in 72 poor countries was estimated that we could prevent about 6.5 million deaths and close to 450 million cases of illness over 10 years. The savings is measured in several billions of dollars. Rino Rappuoli wrote a very interesting review article about almost exactly a year ago, calling it Vaccines for the 21st Century, in which he was talking about vaccines for the entire life cycle, for children, for the elderly, and one of the categories in there was vaccines for poverty. And when you look in the column, you become very, very well aware that we are really sorely lacking in vaccines for that particular group. In fact, they are for virtually all the major neglected diseases, we have a real problem with vaccines. The pipeline is bare. If you show it here on this slide, just a representative selected number of the diseases that we'll be talking about during this conference, the pipeline certainly is not robust in contradistinction to some of the other diseases that we see. However, modern research technologies to address vaccine development for neglected diseases are there, and we need to use them. In fact, a paper that came out a year and a couple of months ago from Greg Polin and others were talking about the top five, what they called game changers in vaccinality and vaccinology, and some of them are listed on a summary here on this slide. One of them is applied immunogenomics, namely the genetic basis of the human immune response. The next generation sequencing, I mentioned that before, the variability in gene expression and the ability to get all of the epitopes on the table that you might use in a vaccine. Cutting edge technologies like proteomics, lipidomics, and glycomics, and advanced bioinformatics. For any of you who are involved in some of these genomic programs, it's very clear that without a very robust informatics, the amount of data that you get would make it almost impossible to fully utilize the advances that you have, as well as a systems biology approach to immune profiling. So what we're really trying to do, as I mentioned just a few minutes ago, is to bring this whole issue of vaccine development for neglected disease into 21st century technology, because it certainly deserves it. And then finally, just a comment about the future. This is the neglected diseases pipeline when you look at drugs, vaccines, and diagnostics. As I already told you, it is not by any means robust. And that is really the big challenge when you think in terms of the three interventions of diagnostics, therapeutics, and vaccines. So the challenge for the future is there. One of the points I want to emphasize when you're talking about these challenges is the importance of partnerships. They are really essential, and we've seen that in every major challenge that we have undertaken, be that with HIV/AIDS or malaria or others. So in order to get these interventions, the vaccines, therapeutics, vector management, diagnostics, et cetera, you do need a consortium of everything from fundamental academic and government-based research support to host country involvement to the G8 and other wealthy countries, to industry, very, very important in industry, and what we call public-private partnerships. So let me just take a few seconds emphasizing the public-private partnerships component. This has been very successful in a number of arenas when you're talking about collaborative product development, namely leveraging private sector expertise. It became very clear to me many years ago that the federal government, even if the interest, and I don't mean the United States federal government, I mean governments in general, with their support for basic research, cannot develop products independently without industry. So to leverage the expertise, I keep getting asked, well, if we're not going to get a vaccine for this, why doesn't the federal government just develop the vaccine? We can push the envelope very close to product development, but we really can't do product development. So you really do need private sector expertise. There's risk sharing. The industry will not make a major investment if there is a very, very high risk. That's just it. It's not that industry are not good people. It's not that they don't have humanitarian motivations, but they have a bottom line that they need to worry about that we, as people who are doing it for other reasons, really don't have to. But we need to engage them, to share risks with them. There's project and portfolio management for both preclinical and clinical development. And then, as we've done and try to do at NIAID, take care of the basic translational and clinical research supports, which complements product development. Again, getting back to the decades of the vaccine, I just want to mention that because that's one of the things that we're really trying to push the envelope over the next 10 years through enhanced collaboration across the international community. And as I said, I've been involved with this over the past couple of years. We've developed a global vaccine action plan. which integrates all aspects of immunization, research, delivery, global access. And we've published in the 2013, soon to come up, we're working on it right now, in the journal Vaccine, which is a special supplement to present current case studies and future directions for vaccine research, development, and delivery. And as a matter of fact, the week after next, actually next week, on December the 18th in Washington, D.C., HHS, together as co-host with the Institute of Medicine, is putting together a meeting of how one can best address the health research needs in the developing world, including neglected diseases. So this is something that has just recently been put on the table, and it's going to occur next week in Washington, D.C. Now, I've been speaking about basic and clinical research. I want to make sure people understand that we fully appreciate in the basic and clinical research arena that we can't just be doing concept development. There are some fundamental, simple things that make implementation possible. So sometimes this gets missed, that you can do research to make implementation easier. We've done it with HIV, and we're going to be doing it with neglected diseases. And some examples are obvious to you. We need simplified dosing schedules, fewer doses of more potent vaccines. We need thermostability. It's not just going to happen, and we are doing research. In fact, we put out RFIs and RFAs on that for dry formulations, ease of administration, needle-free delivery systems, appropriateness of vaccines to the developing country, and an awareness to consider cost-effectiveness of production technologies and not make something that is really a great product but is completely unattainable in the developing world. So we're very, very aware of that. I just want to bring to your attention that the commitment of NIAID over the last several years, despite a flattening of the NIH budget when it talks about global health, which by definition includes neglected diseases, has dramatically increased, if you look at the lower left-hand part of the slide, from 2000 until 2011, has gone triple plus in our commitment to this. And I just want to tell the audience that we feel very strongly about that. And in fact, just a couple of days ago, the G Finder came out showing that the U.S. is the largest public funder of neglected diseases, as we should be, because we're a rich country. I'm not saying that that's something we should be patting ourselves on the back for. But in fact, about $1.5 billion of the U.S. funding accounts for 69% of the global total. But NIH is the principal U.S. public funder, investing about $1.2 billion in neglected disease research and development. And again, I say this not as a kudo to us, but that is almost a challenge that we absolutely need to do more. And there's no doubt about that. And despite the constraints and resources, because it's a neglected diseases, doesn't mean that we should continue to neglect it because we don't have a lot of resources. So I want to end by saying that we are very much committed to working with the international community for what we can contribute, which is fundamental, basic, and clinical research, to be part of the whole big picture of product development and implementation. Thank you very much. But for the next speakers, I'm still talking. Can you hear up here? You can hear me again. Please have the mics and please introduce yourself and name and where you're
from. Okay. Thank you very much, Anthony, for this very nice and very stimulant presentation. I am Dr. Robert Sivak from Sanofi. Just one point. In many meetings and even in the United Nations, we speak about non-communicable disease. It's a big pressure on non-communicable disease. We are a little afraid that to maintain the momentum and the effort already done, how we can maintain the balance in developing and emerging country between non-communicable disease and neglected tropical disease.
Yeah. Yeah, thank you for that question. It's an excellent point. I was, as an infectious disease person, I was asked to talk about neglected infectious tropical diseases, not just tropical, but neglected diseases in general. I'm glad you brought that up. There is a clear need for neglected non-communicable diseases. And as you well pointed out, there was a meeting last year of WHO, which emphasized that, and we are acutely aware of that. We should not separate the two, a neglected disease is a neglected disease. I just happen to be focusing on the infectious diseases today, but you make a very good point.
Dr. Fauci, it's Jennifer Dent from BioVentures for Global Health. If you had to prioritize vaccine development for neglected tropical diseases versus drug development, based on the economic impact of either of these therapeutic choices, which would you prioritize over the other?
You know, that's an unfair question, but I'm going to answer it anyway. I think they both need high priority. And let me explain to you why, because I've been through a decade of this with HIV, where people say, you know, there's treatment and there's prevention. So what do you prioritize? And you really got to go with both. To say, well, you know, vaccine is much more important, then people immediately think you don't really care about therapeutics. So I would say that clearly when you look at track record of cost benefit, it is always better to prevent disease than to treat a disease. But many of diseases of which we have treatment, vaccines are not in the horizon yet. So if you say I'm gonna put my resources much more heavily on vaccines, I think we're doing a disservice to things that we could really have a major impact. Because there are many of the diseases, as you know, you can actually eradicate with treatment without even having a vaccine. So we have to be really, really careful. I would have loved to have give you a two-word answer to it, but there's not a two-word answer to it.
Thank you. I'm Jamie Love. I'm with Knowledge Ecology International. I'm over here. This month, the World Health Organization met to discuss a proposal to increase the amount of funding for neglected diseases. It's been put off to 2016. So my question is, do you think we're spending enough globally on neglected disease research? And if not, don't you think it's important to try and find some way to increase the amount of money that other countries other than the United States spend on these research projects? Thank you.
So, I've been doing this a long time, so you're not going to get me to say something that I'm going to have to answer 300 emails for when I get back to Washington. So I'm not talking about any United States government policies. If you are asking me, as a scientist and a health person, do we need to put more investment in global health? My answer is an unequivocal yes. But I'm not speaking about policy. Okay.
Okay. We can just give one last round of applause to Dr. Fauci.
So as Dr. Fauci departs, I'd like to thank him again. That was just a great kickoff for this conference. And now, without the benefit of sound effects, I'd like to try to welcome you once again to Mount Sinai. I'm Phil Landrigan. I'm the Dean for Global Health at Mount Sinai. We're very proud of this place. We've built a spectacular global health program over the past few years. In the past 12 months, for example, we've had approximately 60 of our medical students and physicians working in more than 25 countries around the world. It's good stuff. This conference draws very much on two key features of our institution, our deep deeply held concern for community, which extends back over 150 years, and our very strong emphasis on innovation. Just a week ago, in this very auditorium, we held a two-day conference on innovation, discussing exactly as we're discussing here today, how do we accelerate the pipeline, how do we use new technologies to get new therapeutics to patients, to the market more quickly. There's an enormous amount of resonance between these two discussions, and I think the goal of this conference, to raise the profile of neglected diseases, to interest funders and to draw attention to the need for greater research investment in these diseases is key. Tony Fauci's slide on the economic benefits is very important. We physicians don't usually think about economics, but I've got to tell you, from having worked in environmental health for many years, which is another neglected area of medicine, that if you can persuade the politicians that an investment is going to save money, it's a very powerful argument. It complements the human argument. So this, conclude my remarks, I want to say how delighted we at Mount Sinai are this morning to be partnering with MSF and with DNDI in this conference, and it's now my great pleasure once again to introduce Dr. Dean Machbein, who's the president of MSF-USA, and she too will attempt to welcome you without sound effects. Thank you, and welcome.
Thank you, Dr. Landrigan. You're really a good sport. And thank you to Mount Sinai for hosting this important conference. We are very grateful that Mount Sinai shares our concern about the lack of acceptable treatments for some of the world's most neglected patients. And we're so happy to see so many experts in the fields of research and development, health policy, advocacy, and health delivery gathered here today. Your expertise and your participation today gives us hope that millions of patients will get the treatments that they need. The places that Doctors Without Borders works are challenging enough. In war zones, in remote and isolated areas, in impoverished areas and communities where there's essentially no health infrastructure. Too often, added to the mix, are limited, ineffective, and sometimes non-existent health tools, as Dr. Fauci pointed out. As a doctor, it's very hard to tell a mother whose son is suffering from living with HIV that there's no pediatric formulation and that she has to crush the adult pills and hope to get the dose right. Or to tell a father with Chagas that there's no test to determine whether or not the treatment that he's just endured that may have painful side effects has been successful. Or to tell a young woman with drug-resistant tuberculosis that she must spend the next 2 years taking dozens of pills a day and injections that may leave her with nausea, deafness, psychosis, and even suicidal ideation, that at the end of it, she has only a 50% chance of survival. Yet these are the conversations that my colleagues are having every day in the field. This is no way to practice medicine in the 21st century. As Dr. Fauci indicated a decade ago, research and development into diseases affecting the poorest was at a standstill. Since then, there have been successful initiatives for treatment on malnutrition, malaria, HIV/AIDS, proving that research and development for neglected diseases can work. But at the same time, we are frustrated at the failed political will, frustrated by the failure to provide leadership and financing for global research and development into diseases that affect the world's most neglected people. And finally, we're frustrated at the possibility of being here in another 10 years voicing the same concerns at the expense of many more lives lost. We need treatments that are patient-friendly, preferably pills, not injections, preferably pediatric formulations that are sweet-tasting. We need one-shot treatments that can work in conflict zones and disaster areas where hospitalization is not always possible. We need vaccines that don't need refrigeration, and preferably don't need to be injected. Looking around this room at the expertise gathered, I'm confident that we can speed up development and delivery of the kinds of treatments and vaccines our patients need. Together, we can pressure political leaders to create mechanisms and coordinate and sustainably finance research and development at a global level and stop delaying concrete action. I feel hopeful that we're at a tipping point that will lead us to a world where people are not dying because no one cared to make treatments for their particular disease. So I'm very happy to see you all today. And again, I turn this over to Rachel Cohen, who represents DNDi North America, that has delivered treatments for malaria, Kalazar, sleeping sickness, that has saved countless lives in our field projects. Thank you.
Thanks, Dean. Thanks, Phil, and a very warm welcome to everyone. Sorry for the technical difficulties this morning. Many of us were in the room 10 years ago when MSF and a little think tank called the Drugs for Neglected Diseases Working Group came together and discussed the crisis in research and development for neglected diseases at the turn of the century. Colleagues presented one of the first critical analyses of the R&D pipeline at that time, what we called the fatal imbalance, which Dr. Fauci referred to. At that time, only 1% of new drugs approved for the 25-year period between 1975 and 1999 were for neglected tropical diseases, including malaria and tuberculosis, despite those diseases representing 12% of the global disease burden. This, in part, led to the creation of DNDi, the Drugs for Neglected Diseases Initiative, in 2003 by MSF and by five public sector research partners, many of whom are in the room today, from Brazil, India, Kenya, Malaysia, France, as well as TDR. So this conference has special meaning for those of us with DNDi and all of our partners in the room and around the world. It represents the launch of our 10-year anniversary and gives us an opportunity to celebrate successes, but more importantly, to highlight ongoing challenges, gaps, and opportunities for transformative change. Part of the rationale behind this conference, as Dean and others have mentioned, is to take a look at the past 10 years, to critically and honestly reflect on what progress has been made and what shortcomings remain in the fight for innovation that addresses the needs of the most neglected patients. As Dean mentioned, in the past 10 to 15 years, various initiatives and organizations have sprung up and tried to fill critical R&D gaps, which had gone unresolved or totally ignored for decades. And some progress has been made. You'll hear later today about an analysis by DNDi and MSF of the R&D pipeline for neglected diseases in the last 12 years. But we're also counting on you in these next 2 days to help expose critical and persistent failings and to chart a way forward, to clearly lay out what can be done both immediately to improve the lives of patients today and in the future to accelerate the discovery, development, and delivery of new health technologies for patients who continue to be neglected by the market. We will do so in part, as you've heard, through the lens of 3 case studies focusing on drug-resistant tuberculosis, Chagas disease, and certain vaccine-preventable illnesses. Ultimately, as several colleagues in the room have said over and over the years, medical innovation really must aim to change medical practice for the benefit of patients. An invention alone cannot be considered an innovation if those who need it most cannot access it. What is needed, therefore, is certainly a new paradigm, a different way to think about how research and development is prioritized, how it's financed, how it's coordinated, and how it can be sustainably financed. A system that does not just stimulate innovation, but that generates the right kind of innovation and that guarantees access to the fruits of this innovation, ultimately that transforms science into life-saving tools to diagnose, treat, and prevent disease. And I can think of no better way to get this urgent conversation going than by asking our first chair, our first moderator, to join me on the stage.